Morning and welcome to the 14th meeting of the Criminal Justice Committee. We've got no apologies this morning, and can I ask everyone to please ensure that their mobile phones are switched to silent, and if you can wait for the sound engineer to switch your microphone on before speaking. Our first item is to agree whether to take item 5 in private and whether our work programme reviews of evidence heard and our approach to forthcoming legislation should be considered in private at future meetings. Does anybody disagree? Thank you very much. Our next item of business is the continuation of our consideration of evidence on efforts to improve the ways in which we prosecute violence against women and girls, and also how we support the survivors of such crimes. And I refer members to papers 1 and 2. And I'm pleased to welcome to today's meeting two senior representatives from Police Scotland, Deputy Chief Constable Malcolm Graham of the Crime and Operational Support Division, and Detective Chief Superintendent Sam Falls, Head of the Public Protection Unit within the Specialist Crime Division. And I'd like to allow up to an hour for this panel, but before I start, I'll just go through some a few practical points. So this is a fully virtual meeting, and I intend to use chat function as the means of communicating between us. So if you do want to come in, please type an R in the chat function and I'll bring you in if time allows. If we do lose connection at any point with a member or a key witness, I'll suspend the meeting and we'll try and get them back. And if we can't do so after a reasonable period of time, I'll have to deem the member as not present and we'll continue. If we do lose connection to me, our deputy convener will take over convening. And if we lose him too, then our colleague Rona Mackay will step in as our temporary convener with the committee's agreement. So please, can everyone keep their questions and answers as succinct as possible? And if there are no questions at this point, we'll make a start. And can I refer members to the order of questions sheet? So I'd like to open up this morning's session and come to you, DCC Graham. So if I may ask just a little bit about Lady Dorian's review. So in the written evidence that was submitted to the committee, to the committee's roundtable on violence against women and girls back in September, Police Scotland listed the recommendations that they supported from Lady Dorian's review on the management of sexual offences cases, including, for example, the creation of a specialist court for serious cases, independent legal representation for complainers, and single judge trials in rape cases. So can I ask you, DCC Graham, just a little bit about what action Police Scotland has already taken to date in response to the recommendations, bearing in mind that the report was first published back in March this year. I can bring you in.
Thanks very much, convener, and good morning to everyone. And thanks very much for the opportunity, actually, for the session today. Sorry that we can't be with you in person, which I'm sure everybody shares with the sudden uptake in Omicron, but hugely valuable process that you're going through in terms of, you know, listening to victims and survivors' experiences, and that's critical to informing the shape of future and current work that Police Scotland are leading, builds on work that actually we have been doing, as I think you're aware, for many years, and most recently, just before this process started, the Chief Constable met with DCS Falls and others through Rape Crisis Scotland with survivors and heard the brave accounts of experiences and that valuable feedback that we have used to shape our both thinking and action. In relation to Lady Dorian's report, some elements which you've covered there are less directly within the gift of Police Scotland to shape and influence at pace. And I think the main thing that I would focus upon, which is more within our gift, certainly in the earlier stages, is the visual recording of interviews to allow evidence to be given through that means. And we have been involved in setting up and running a test of change, which commenced relatively shortly after the report was published, and which has actually just ended during the course of last month, in which the evaluation is now being done. I think it's my full expectation that following that test of change in three of the local policing divisions in Police Scotland, we will seek to, of course, look at the evaluation and see what worked well and what didn't. But it's a direction of travel that we are fully supported and effectively engaged in, and I fully anticipate that will roll out further. I think the challenges to that are, as we will no doubt come to on other points, and as I alluded to in some of other Lady Dorian's recommendations, that this needs system-wide change. And whilst we can record the interviews, and there are some challenges for us in terms of making sure we have appropriately skilled staff, that we give them the time and space, the experience and the support to do those interviews in a way that's firstly going to gather the evidence properly and secondly going to support traumatised victims, there are cost implications for us which we're working through in terms of ensuring we have the resource to spend on the rollout of new technology. And I think more importantly perhaps for this committee, the material that we will produce, which will be high quality, large volume digital material, needs to be able to be shared and accessed across the criminal justice system in a way that's commensurate with disclosure obligations, and in a way that also treats the nature of the material and the rights of victims with all the safeguards that you would expect. And at the moment, the system through the Crown Office, Procurator Fiscal Service, and into the Court Service and the Judiciary isn't yet ready to do that fully. So I think we are pushing ahead and we're engaged in the digital evidence sharing programme, which all of the justice system has signed up to and the police are leading. And through measures like that and investment in the technology, we'll make sure that these things happen in the future.
Thanks very much, Mr. Graham, and I'm pleased to hear that hear this update in particular around the sort of visual recording of interviews, and certainly take your point around the sort of challenge of this really being part of a system change. And in terms of pushing ahead with some of those changes, do you have a kind of time frame in terms of what requires to be done to put visual recording in place, in particular around serious and sexual offences interviews?
Yeah, I think there are three aspects to it. I think the first aspect is ensuring that we have the sort of technical equipment and that we can get suitable facilities, and understand, I think quite rightly, that there's been feedback on some of the Police Scotland estate and facilities that victims of serious sexual crime and rape are interviewed in. And we want to make sure that we are seriously looking at investing in that estate as we move towards visual recording of interviews to ensure that people are as comfortable, that they're in as suitable a setting as possible at such a difficult time in their life. And that's then sort of complemented by the investment in the technology that's required. And it's not just recording devices, it's really the infrastructure that sits behind that to manage the volume of data that effectively is gathered. So that's the first area. And I don't think that's going to be the limiting factor in terms of pace going forward, because we're well advanced with that. I think the second factor is the skills and the training that we need to give to sexual offences liaison officers. We commenced that in May of this year. We've already trained a large number of the solo cadre of the people that are involved in the pilots. I think we've trained all the solos in those areas. I think we've actually conducted 230 plus interviews during the course of the pilot, so it gives us a really good number to evaluate. We will, of course, feed back into that training loop and make sure that we get feedback from some of the trusted agencies, in effect, who are feeding back victims and survivors' experience to us so that we can shape that as we go. And again, I think that's making good progress, and we have plans to roll that out commensurate with the evaluation. I think the third area is the point I raised earlier about the wider justice system ability to absorb and use this material in the way that it's intended for. It only has a benefit if it can see its way through to the criminal justice system at the points where it's going to make a difference to the experience that a victim has, and hopefully improve both the opportunities of evidence being used in the way that's intended, as well as ensuring that the victim's experience is improved from those accounts that we've heard. The Scottish Government have convened a group now and have written, I believe the Cabinet Secretary for Justice wrote to Lord Carloway just in the course of the last 2 weeks, and I'm attending the first meeting of the group that the Scottish Government is convening next week to set up the procedures for how the wider considerations in Lady Dorian's report will be addressed collectively and collaboratively, and therefore the timescales for that are not yet set.
Thanks very much, and we certainly look forward to updates on how that particular area of work is progressing. I'm going to move things on now, and I'd like members to open up some questions around taking statements, and I'll bring in Colette Stevenson and then Pauline McNeill. Over to you, Colette.
Yeah, good morning, and thanks, convener, and thanks very much to our two witnesses from Police Scotland. As you'll probably be aware, we had a private session with victims of sexual crime, varying degrees of it, and a quite powerful testament that they brought forward. So I really just wanted to ask you some questions around your process in terms of taking statements, and really in terms of from the onset right through and what information is provided to the complainer, and if you could just give me a wee bit of insight, even just like a walkthrough. So if I presented to you today as a complainer of a sexual or violent crime, what would I expect to see from Police Scotland?
Okay, thanks very much. And I'm mindful of the experience that you've had in listening to and understanding the experience of survivors who have come forward. I've said we really value that feedback, and I've looked carefully at the reports coming from the Appeal Committee, as well as all the experiences that we've put in place. I mean, the first thing I wanted to say, I suppose, is we are actively exploring more structured and sustainable mechanisms for ensuring that we continue to listen, understand and reflect on victim experiences. It's hugely valuable getting that insight. And I'm in active discussions with a number of groups who are keen to work with us in that regard. In terms of your question, I'll perhaps come to DCS Faulds as well to provide a little bit more detail in that. But broadly speaking, there is a pathway that victims should experience when they come forward from the first point of making a report. It's likely that they will do that through a report being made by telephone. And at that point, the people who answer calls and make assessments on prioritisation are trained both at a basic level in terms of trauma-informed approaches, but also in terms of the steps that they need to take if somebody's reporting a sexual offence or a serious sexual offence like a rape. And that will be assessed by a supervisor, and then it will be passed out for dispatch to an officer to attend as an emergency response in the instance of it being a recent event, and in the event of something that is perhaps non-recent, there may be an arrangement made at a more suitable time for the individual contacting the police to be seen directly by a specialist officer. In the case of a recent event, then there is comprehensive guidance, which is in effect a set of things that an attending officer needs to do to ensure that they take account of medical and other welfare needs of the victim, that they take an initial account of what's happened to be able to assess the nature of what we're dealing with, and that they capture any early evidence. And actually, on the back of some of the feedback we've had recently, we have strengthened that advice because we recognise that at that point, it needs to be every officer in Police Scotland that is trained and competent to do that work. Of course, a lot of these reports will come through a different route. They don't necessarily come through somebody phoning up and directly reporting what's happened. It may start off, for instance, with the report of a domestic assault, which then develops into an understanding of there being a sexual crime or a rape, for instance. And through the course of that, the route would still be the same, that there will be referral into a specialist department within a local policing division, and that specialist department will deploy a sexual offences liaison officer, who's a specially trained officer, to ensure that they then take a statement and gather all the evidence, as well as informing the victim at that time of what is likely to happen during the course of this process, and what's likely to happen thereafter. Again, we've strengthened the information that's provided both to victims at that point and the need, I think, which has been consistent feedback, to keep in touch with victims thereafter. I mean, there's an awful lot more detail that I could go into because the question's very broad, and I'm conscious of time, so I won't do that, but I'd be very happy to answer any more detailed points on bits that I might have covered at fairly high level, or indeed, as I suggested earlier, perhaps invite DCS Falls to provide some more detail on elements of that process that you're particularly interested in.
Yeah, thank you very much for that response. And could I bring DCS Falls in and basically ask the same question and just explore her understanding of it?
I don't know if we've got DCS Falls. Can you hear us okay?
Good morning.
Yep, we can hear you now. Go ahead.
All right, thank you. So that's been covered very comprehensively by the Deputy Chief Constable there. What I would say is that the DCC has covered the various routes that we can get these reports and the fact that they're assessed in terms of threat, risk and harm, whether it's recent or non-recent. And there are a number of impacting factors, for example, whether the incident falls within a forensic window. But regardless, we take on board, we have regular contact with Rape Crisis Scotland and the various rape crisis support organisations across the country, the teams across the country and other advocacy services, and we take on board all the feedback that we get from them. And in actual fact, what has been reassuring is that we always listen to that and we do take it on board, and we feed any both positive and negative feedback gets passed back to the SIO cadre, the Senior Investigating Officer cadre, etc., to make sure that we're continuously working to improve our response to victims. And in the last year or two, the feedback has been positive in the majority, but we always welcome that negative or critical feedback as well, so that we can learn from that. In terms of that initial response, we recently, just this year, refreshed and updated our initial briefing report, which is completed by the initial attending officers who go out and engage with the victim in the first instance. And that briefing report provides clear and unequivocal guidance for the first responder police officers following the report of rape or serious sexual crime. And that includes guidance on minimum standards of information that's required, guidance in respect of the use of early evidence kits, for example, forensic medical examination, and Rape Crisis Scotland referrals, and it's a template to record any evidence that's seized at that point. After that, a solo officer will be deployed. So that IBR, or that initial briefing report, only captures the basic details, because what we have tried to develop and improve is a victim-centred, trauma-informed approach to this, and we understand the impact of trauma, or we try to understand, we try to train officers to understand the impact of trauma. And a specialist officer, as the DCC mentioned, sexual offences liaison officer, who are specially trained, will then be deployed and make contact with the victim and make arrangements to take a statement at a point that is suitable for the victim themselves as well, so that we're not re-traumatising them, or trying not to. But like I said, we have had meetings with Rape Crisis. We've had a meeting with the Survivors Reference Group. It's absolutely disappointing and disheartening to hear that people have had negative experiences, but those negative experiences that they're willing to share with us inform what we're doing, and we're trying to learn from that and improve.
Okay, thanks very much for that, DCS Folds. I just want to quickly come in, and it was more or less a question slash observation that I made and I put forward to our witnesses from last week's committee. And it was in terms of the feedback that we got from the survivor group, and the disjointed, you know, approach in terms, and an expectation gap there in terms of reporting a sexual crime. And one of the things was within Rape Crisis Scotland, there's a video there for, and I think it's on YouTube, is RCS Survivor's Guide to Scottish Justice. Is that something that you currently use within your website, or do you direct any complainers towards that, or is there something that you currently have in order to support that? Because I personally found that really helpful, albeit the reality sometimes didn't match up with the process.
DCS Folks, would you like to come back in very briefly, if you would?
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I'm personally aware of that video. I have watched it. It's been part of my training in the past. And I am aware that other officers have seen it. What I would say is that I'm not sure if it's on our own intranet, and I will take that back and check. But if I've seen it and other colleagues I know have seen it, then I'm sure it actually forms part of the training. And it is a very helpful resource, and we always signpost rape victims. They are always asked if they would like a referral to Rape Crisis Scotland.
Okay, thank you. I've been for the question, so I'll pass you over to the convener. Thanks.
Thank you very much indeed. If I can just ask for succinct questions and answers, we have until just before 10:30 this morning, and I know that members have got quite a lot of questions they'd like to get through. So I'll hand over to Pauline McNeill, and then I'll bring in Rona Mackay. Pauline.
Thank you very much, Convener. The first question I have relates to DNA results. We heard from one survivor who told us that it took a year. I'm imagining that's unusual, but I wondered if you could tell me if there's a window of certain timescale for DNA results, because we were advised or told by the survivor that the case could not proceed without that. And I just wanted to get your answer on whether there was any other concerns in the system about getting quicker evidence and DNA results. Thank you.
Yeah, I'm happy to come in and answer that question in relation to forensics. I think, first of all, it's important to say that every forensic examination is prioritised against threat, risk and opportunity. And it isn't a case of just sending a sample or a set of samples to be tested and waiting for one set of results. It's often an iterative process where, you know, different samples will be examined for different things at different stages during the course of an investigation. So it certainly wouldn't be the case that, you know, a set of samples would be taken submitted for testing where it was critical that there was an answer for it to progress, and there would be a delay of a year in, for instance, the rape. Not at all. But it might be the case that through the course of a series of examinations, that process takes some time. In terms of prioritisation, rape and sexual crime comes very high in that prioritisation list, along with other unsolved major investigations like murders. That there isn't anything that we would prioritise more highly. And I think where we're looking at delays in forensic examinations more routinely, and there has been some public reporting on this, it's likely to be around about high volume drugs offences, for instance, in drugs examinations, or in less serious crimes where, for instance, we could solve things like housebreakings or acquisitive crime through perhaps DNA examination, and they would clearly not be prioritised to the same extent as rape and sexual crime. So I think in terms of timescales, I don't have concerns that they are limiting cases in any way. The data shows us that clearly. I think what we do need to do, and we've received this feedback before, and Sam's alluded to our desire to improve in this, is make sure that we are both explaining fully perhaps the complexity of some of the examination considerations and process to victims with samples from different opportunities, whether from a forensic examination of themselves or whether from clothing and other items. It can be hugely complex in any single case. Make sure that we're explaining that in as much detail as is appropriate, and that we're also updating complainers to make sure that they understand why these timescales might be what they are, and making sure that we are able to give them confidence that reporting will come in good time for other elements of whatever process is playing out. And I think those points are well made.
Pauline, back to you.
Thank you. Just a quick question to DS Walls. You talked about the specialist sexual offences as liaison officers. Does every complainer get access to that, or is that just here and there?
So I do apologise that the moderator was muting and then unmuting, and the machine was talking over you, Ms McNeill. Could you repeat the question?
You mentioned in answer to Colette Stevenson that there were sexual offence officers that took statements when it was more suitable for the victim. Does that happen in every case? Every rape
case?
Right,
sorry. If I've not been clear, what I mean is the sexual offence liaison officer will always be deployed to a victim of rape, always, on every occasion. And what I'm saying is the time and date of taking the statement would be at a time suitable for the victim, wherever possible, and where the threat, risk and harm allows that to happen, But no, in every case of rape being reported, we will deploy a solo officer, and we have a significant cadre of solos across the force, in excess of 700 specially trained officers across the force.
100. Well, that's really helpful to know that. Perhaps, DS Falls, I'm just going to maybe follow up my last question. It might be to you, perhaps. The potential use of recorded police interviews is something the committee's heard about, and I wondered if either yourself or Deputy Constable Malcolm Graham could just tell the committee how that might go forward. I mean, I do recall a time where such a thing as a precognition statement taken to all witnesses, but that doesn't seem to happen anymore. And I just wondered if a recorded police interview, what will that actually be?
So I think in terms of the visually recorded interview, our aim is, it's not just our aim, it's the aim of the Crown Office, Procurator, Fiscal Service and the Court Service, and actually everybody involved in this, is to, ultimately prevent witnesses or victims having to attend at court and give evidence. So if we record a visually recorded statement that allows that evidence to be tested and evidence to be given on commission. So I think that the DCC mentioned the test of change that we were running. We've been running that for 2 years now in three areas. We've evaluated it from a police interview perspective. We're still waiting on that be tested in court because there have been very obvious impacts on the court process and delays in that going through. But we are continuing to run those VRIs, and the feedback that we've had from them and from victims has been very positive, and that is a more positive and supportive experience for them. And in our view, we would like to be in a position to VRI every witness that, you know, that wanted to be VRI'd. And it's just those interdependencies that the DCC already mentioned that are currently kind of holding us back from that. But our aim is to roll that out nationally.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much. I'll now bring in Rona Mackay, and then followed by Jamie Green.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. I just wanted to really follow up on the questions from my colleagues there, and to say that, you know, what you've put forward as the process sounds very encouraging, but I'd like to put forward some of the evidence that we heard during our sessions and just to say that the process you described certainly wasn't happening in this instance. And you know, we heard that survivors are often given asked to provide statements when they're in a traumatised state. Officers didn't make them aware of the support available. One said that it was a solo male officer who took the statement, and the process took hours. They weren't allowed to have a break or have a drink of water, and then they were immediately asked, immediately given a forensic examination. And I found all that pretty shocking, because I don't think you need to be specially trained to know that that's not very considerate treatment. Can I just ask you then, I suppose my question is, if you hear of a situation where the guidance wasn't followed, and that may be an extreme case, but you know, if it wasn't, what action would you take? And what redress does the complainer have if they've experienced a situation like that? How do they make it known to you that the guidance wasn't followed, and do they have any redress? If I could ask DCC Malcolm Graham first, and then maybe Samantha Falls after that.
No, thanks very much. And I was aware of that example from reading the report. And I suppose just to repeat what I said about our desire to hear that kind of feedback and make sure that we've got means of doing that. I mean, I fully recognise that anybody that comes to report to the police, and clearly not everybody does who is a victim, which is an issue in itself, but when people do get to the point of coming to report to the police, it's highly likely that they will be in a traumatised state, and that they will be in that state for a long period of time. It's not something that's necessarily going to be something that people can transition out of quickly. And for us to recognise that and deal with the things that are going to best support them through the police and then criminal justice process needs to recognise how we do that in a trauma-informed way. But I think explaining the process, making sure that people have a choice of a female sex offences liaison officer, making sure that there are breaks and water available, these are all very basic things which I would expect to be in place on every occasion. If they're not in place on some occasions, then of course we would like to hear about that. But I also understand why people who are the victims at that state are unlikely to want to flag that at the time or find the means easily to do that. And therefore, that's why we have in place all the systems we have, with particularly Rape Crisis Scotland, a structured approach of gathering feedback from victims about the experience with solos. And the feedback from that is overwhelmingly positive. In over 80% of examples, it's extremely positive. And in the cases where it's not, we always pick up the issues, we play it back into individuals, and we make sure that it's fed back to, if there's a theme in a particular division or area, with supervision at the time. But we also ensure that it's built into to policy and practice going forward. The final thing I would say is that it is, you know, an awful time in people's lives. And to go back to that point about people being traumatised, we recognise that. And to go through giving an account of what has happened to you, to do it in what will be an unusual or unfamiliar environment, and to have to undergo a forensic examination are never going to be pleasant experiences for anybody. I can only seek to appreciate that from listening to the experiences of others, as I have done, and make sure that we do everything we can to minimise any kind of further trauma that would come to people from that. Of course, the visually recorded interview is a part of that to ensure, as DCS Falls has already said, that in the future people will only need to give that account once, and that we get that account at the time that is most suitable. And we're doing everything that we can, both to hear the feedback on the points that you've raised, to address that through action on our part, and to minimise any further trauma to victims at what is a horrendously difficult time in their lives.
Thank you. That's helpful. I'm not sure if DCS Falls wants to come in, or she may have answered it in her earlier response.
I think there's only one other part that I would add to that, and we don't always get it right, and we acknowledge that, and one victim having a poor experience with us is one victim too many. But the whole feedback process has been reviewed this year in consultation with Rape Crisis Scotland and other advocacy services, actually to capture feedback from victims in the broader violence against women and girls environment. And what we're looking to do is set up structured feedback for all of those services so that it's qualitative and that actually we can capture the learning in as quick a time as possible to inform the training and the guidance moving forward. So that is something that has been under review for the last few months, particularly during COVID, to make sure that we are capturing that feedback.
Okay, thanks very much. That's helpful. Thank you, Convener.
Thanks very much, Rona. Jamie, would you like to come in, and then we'll move on to looking at trauma-informed training? Jamie, back to you.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, everyone. I just wanted to follow on this line of questioning. I won't elongate it too much, because I think you've covered a lot, and there seems to be a general acceptance that, of course, things always don't go well 100% of the time, and every case that doesn't go well, I'm sure, is unfortunate. But I think what struck members of the committee was just the scale of and the volume of feedback that we got that was negative, rather than this seemed to be isolated incidents. The whole experience of reporting an incident like this does seem to be quite traumatic. I wanted to ask two quick things. The first one is just whether you think, or what improvements you think could be made around the environment in which crimes of this nature are reported, given that we hear they tend to take place at a certain time of day, on certain days of the week, so weekends, during the night or early in the mornings, that some of the witnesses or indeed the victims may themselves be intoxicated or under the influence voluntarily or otherwise, and of course that during the night some of the officers at the front desk and on the front line maybe are not as trauma-informed as other officers would be other times of day. So is there anything more you think the police could do to ensure that that first point of contact isn't as traumatic and scary as it seems to be for many victims? And that's directed at anyone who wants to respond.
Yeah, I think the short answer to that is yes, there could be improvements made. I look back, as I do, over all of the issues that we're discussing over nearly 30 years in policing, and the changes that we have made have been seismic in terms of the approach towards victims, recognising the impact of trauma, the attitudes and behaviours of police officers and staff, and the culture in the organisation has improved seismically. And I don't use those words lightly, but it is really clear that there are more improvements to make from the feedback that we're getting at the current time. I don't necessarily identify with I think you've spoken to, you know, a number of victims whose experiences are undoubtedly those that have happened to them. But I think with the broader feedback that we get, I would contextualise that in a very large amount of positive feedback about people's experiences as well, which, go back to my earlier answer, it is an incredibly challenging time in people's lives. I think in terms of improvements, there's probably two things I would say. The first is sort of more general awareness and training, which we are engaged in as an organisation, about trauma-informed approaches and the respect and sort of human elements of addressing the needs of somebody who presents themselves, as you say, at whatever time and in whatever circumstances, so that we can ensure that person's needs are best met. I think secondly, there's the point about then our specially trained officers having a much higher level of understanding and the time and space and the right facilities to ensure that people's needs are met. And part of that's about skills training, which we're going through with our sexual offence liaison officers, and we're part way through that. And it's now a key element. And there's 2 days in the sexual offence liaison officer course now that are entirely dedicated to trauma-informed approaches. And of course, estates and facilities and ensuring it's a welcoming and as conducive an environment as possible when we get to, you know, recording VRIs, etc., is a key part of that as well. So yeah, I acknowledge there is more work to do, but I would also want to note that there's been a huge amount of work and improvement made in a lot of these issues already.
Thank you for that response. And it's welcome. I know we're going to come on to the issue of training, others have questions on it, but you know, my scenario that I paint is of 4 or 5 in the morning on a Saturday into a Sunday. What is the likelihood of someone who's had that robust and comprehensive training actually being at hand in a local police station in the middle of nowhere, who, you know, maybe only takes a couple of incidents like this a year? So, you know, is it more likely that we'll see that sort of response in our large cities where the volume is higher, or where you simply have more staff on duty, and that those in, say, rural environments or small towns will be less likely to get that sort of trauma-informed approach?
Yeah, again, I think it's a fair point to raise that we're certainly acutely aware of the potential for there being different responses because of rural or remote locations. But of course, at times that can improve the response that people get as well. Our plan is to ensure that every officer, member of staff gets a basic level of awareness around about trauma-informed approaches, and that specialist officers are available in every location, whether rural, remote or urban, across the whole of Scotland, and that is currently the case. Of course, it might take a little bit longer to get a sexual offences liaison officer to somebody in a very remote area, but again, there are measures in place to ensure that's the case. I think thereafter there are other challenges which are well reported, which we've been working as a part of to ensure that people get access to suitable medical and forensic examination facilities as well in some of those areas, which I think are at times even more challenging, and which we've been working through with some Scottish Government and NHS-led work, which is still continuing.
I think BCS Folds wants to come in as well, just with that.
BCS Folds, you want to come in?
Yes, thanks, Convener. Just to add to what the DCC is saying, we give very clear guidance about not obtaining statements from a very traumatised or a victim. You mentioned there, Mr Green, about a victim who was perhaps under the influence of alcohol during the night. So that's what I mentioned earlier about we take those initial details for an initial briefing document to allow a senior investigating officer to deploy a specialist officer, and that would happen later in the morning and there would be contact. So I don't really recognise that, and I absolutely accept that that's happened, that's the survivor's experience and they've shared that with us and with yourselves, but I would probably question maybe when that happened, because the guidance in the last, certainly in the last 2 years, has been that that should not be happening. But obviously, where it does, we will pick that up and hopefully respond to that individual appropriately if they want to raise that with us, and we would welcome them raising it with us.
That's very helpful. Thank you for that. I know we're tight for time, Convener. Do I have time for one more question, and then I'm happy to pass on to others?
Yes, absolutely. We will be able to extend the session by about 15 minutes, but if again I can remind everyone for succinct questions and answers, that would be helpful. Back to you, Jamie.
Thank you. It's a short question, but maybe a difficult one. In the year 2019 to 2020, there were around 2,300 reported rapes in Scotland, reported to police, of which around 300 went to prosecution and around 130 were successfully prosecuted. We all know that's a ratio that I think everyone wants to change and improve. But what role do you think the police can play in that? Because obviously the taking of an initial statement is only one bit of it. There has to be more evidence gathering and a robust case being given to the Crown to improve those prosecution rates. So can I just ask what you think more the police could do to ensure that ratio improves in the coming years?
No, thank you. And I certainly agree with you that we've all got the ambition to see that rate increase. And certainly the part that the police play is in gathering the evidence and ensuring that the material for the case is prepared to the highest of standards, that's reported into the Crown, and we remain involved in ensuring that that further evidence is gathered to support any prosecution. The number of rapes that are reported to the Crown is higher, I think, than it's perhaps ever been. I'm not entirely sure, and it's certainly higher than it's been in recent years, at nearly 55% during the first 6 months of this year. And that's a remarkably high level. And whilst I acknowledge the number of prosecutions that are ultimately result in a finding of guilt through the courts is lower than I think people would want to see, I think we should recognise some of the unique challenges in these cases in terms of the nature and availability of evidence compared with perhaps some other cases, which again has been well rehearsed. I mean, that said, there are some systemic challenges which have been well recognised as well. I think that the recommendations in Lady Doran's report that we talked about earlier are seeking to address that in many ways, and be fully supportive of doing everything we can to improve those. Specifically, what the police can do, in addition to the commitment that we've already spoken about in Lady Doran's report, I think that everything we've spoken about today will contribute towards ensuring that those things I mentioned earlier are achieved, that victims feel able to come forward in the first place, to have confidence in the police and the criminal justice system needs some work, and we've spoken about that already. We know that there's a high level of under-reporting, therefore under-recording of these crimes. And we need to do as much as we can to ensure that people do come forward. And again, you know, there has been a steady trend, despite a small drop in the midst of the initial stages of the pandemic, which I would attribute to the pandemic. There's been a steady trend of substantive increases in reporting and recording, a large portion of which I would put down to the victim confidence and the support that we have through a number of victim support and advocacy agencies and being a route into policing as well. I think the other things that we can do, I've covered largely already in terms of the professional trauma-informed approaches of officers to supporting victims' needs and making sure that we're gathering evidence to the highest of standards, and as techniques and knowledge develop in those areas, can only be a good thing in terms of the likelihood of those contributing towards those aims that we share.
Thanks very much. Jamie, anything else you'd like to pick up on?
No, just other than tell DCS folks to add some supplementary commentary.
DCS folks, would you like to come in?
Yes, very quickly. I think the only other thing I would add to that is that in the last few years, we've developed significantly the proactive approach, where police officers are identifying victims and making a proactive approach to them and affording them the opportunity to report matters that they maybe never have previously reported. That's a very effective tactic that often allows us to gather corroboration and report cases to Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service. And obviously, we have tried to develop impact of prevention campaigns and work with other partners in terms of education as well. So that's the only part I would add to that.
Thank you.
OK, thank you very much. I'll just move swiftly on and I'll bring in Fulton McGregor just to ask some questions around trauma-informed training, which I know we've been covering off. But over to you, Fulton.
Thanks, Convener. And as you say, I think the issues around trauma-informed training and practice has been quite well covered in the responses to my colleagues Jamie Green and Rona Mackay, and actually also throughout the session. And I'm in no way bothered about that, I have to say, because I'm no way precious about my questioning, because I think it's actually good that you know that both officers today have come on and actually proactively talked about the trauma-informed training that they're doing. I mean, they'll both be aware that obviously Lady Dorian recommended a one consistent trauma-informed source of contact from the outset. We're hearing today a wee bit about the liaison officers. They could perhaps work to that, but they could perhaps fit into that model. But I suppose my question would be is trying to find a new question around this, because as I say, it has been covered. Would be how do we get these specialist officers to the individual as quickly as possible? Because I think some of the issues that we've heard is while there'll be a general level of training throughout the whole force and the various different criminal justice agencies, it might not always be to the same standard as these specialist officers. So how can we get to them quickly, and how long can they stay with the victim or the complainer, whatever word you want to use, how long can they stay with them in the process? Thanks.
I'll maybe kick off. Thanks for that and the acknowledgement of some of the other discussion we've already had. I think the role of the Sexual Offences Liaison Officer has been a huge improvement since it was introduced many years ago now. The evolution and investment in that role has provided that single point of contact. These are individuals who also have sort of welfare and wellbeing needs, and whilst a lot of them I consistently see, and I'm sure DCS Ford will back this up from her own experience as well, I consistently see people making themselves available out with duty hours and having mobile contact with victims. We need to make sure that people are not necessarily available 24 hours a day, 7 days a week as individuals, because we need to make sure that they're also able to get some rest and recuperation from what is extremely demanding and challenging work for them. So it may be the case whilst there's a single point of contact, that person is not always going to be available 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. And I don't think anyone would expect that they should be. So we need to make sure there are other arrangements in place to ensure people know kind of who to contact and know that there have been understandable concerns about getting through to the right person through the 101 system, etc. And we are looking at that to ensure that there is some consistency in the eventuality of a solo not being immediately available. And on the point of them being available for rapid deployment, I haven't heard that that's been an issue in terms of speed of availability. I think that in some cases, timing is one to be carefully considered. It's not always the case that you would want to get somebody out immediately. Actually, it might be better for the victim that somebody is available when it best suits them, particularly in non-recent cases, which do make up about a third of those rapes that are reported to us. And therefore, consideration of when and where the most appropriate time on a case-by-case basis is really important. But I haven't heard any experiences that would suggest that a sexual offence liaison officer isn't available for a sort of prolonged period of time. I'm going to let DCS Fold say a little bit more about that in detail from the feedback we get from solos and their supervisors.
So if I could just come in behind the DCC with that one, as the DCC says, that's not something that we frequently get any feedback about the timing, for example, that it takes to have a solo officer deployed to a victim, and we do that as quickly as possible. I have made mention of the fact that, you know, somebody who, that was already mentioned, the example that was given, somebody under the influence of alcohol, perhaps, and during the night and needs a sleep, that person should be afforded that time, and the solo would be deployed the following morning. In terms of contact throughout the solo, we try to make sure it's the same individual who maintains solo contact. If the solo changes for any reason, for example, if a person, it does happen, people move on, they get promoted or they retire or they leave the service, and we have to have a handover. That handover should be in a structured manner that makes sure the victim remains informed at all times. I think the old Lady Dorian's report goes beyond that, and it looks at a point of contact for victims throughout the whole criminal justice process. And obviously that's not something that the police could, are probably best placed for, those reasons that we can't have the same person available 24/7. And that's why victim advocacy services, victim support services, etc., are critical in this role throughout the whole entire journey for the victim, and not just for where there's police involvement up until the trial.
Thanks very much for that. I think, convener, in the interest of time, and given that the responses have been quite extensive, I'm quite happy to leave it at that, and thank both panellists for their contributions.
Thanks very much, Fulton. Just again, in the spirit of timekeeping, if I can ask for questions and answers to be succinct, I'm going to hand over now to Katie Clark to come in with some questioning around misogyny within policing, and then I'll finally bring in Russell Finlay. So over to you, Katie.
Thank you very much. We know that there have been repeated concerns raised about misogynistic and sexist behaviour in Police Scotland, and there have been numerous complaints. We tried to look at, you know, to get more detail on that, but there isn't gender-specific information available. But in terms of complaints that did get to the police commissioner in 2020-2021, out of 279 referrals, we understand that only 202 were investigated at the time of reporting. So, you know, all we need to do is to open the papers, and we see the Sarah Everard case, and obviously the detail of that case will lead women to lose trust in the police. We read that there's a very high level of domestic abuse, violence by police officers, if you read the media. And we know that there are harassment cases that have been reported to the police, although we don't know the detail of that. So could you maybe both outline what work is being done to implement the final report on investigations, conducts and complaints from November 2020. You know, if you could outline, you know, how you're going to address the issues raised by Dame Angelini in her report, but could you also outline what you believe needs to be done, whether you think that there is a significant cultural problem within the police that needs to be addressed. And if you don't think there's a cultural problem, how do you explain some of what is being reported and what is being said?
CCC, Graham, would you like to pick that up? And as briefly as you can.
Yeah, thank you. I mean, there's a lot in that question, and I will try to be brief, but I think there's a lot to say as well. I mean, the first thing is any such behaviour, and you've mentioned a range of cases from out with Scotland and referred to Police Scotland, any of these cases is abhorrent. It's directly in opposition to the values of Police Scotland and to the role of office that a constable holds, or indeed any member of staff, and the reasons that the vast majority of our people come to work to ensure that we're providing a service to the public, and to do so in a way that's commensurate with the values, ethics and rights of everyone to be safe at work and to be treated with equality. I think there is a very strong link between the confidence that people should have in our ability to provide a public service for all the things we've been talking about today in terms of rape, sexual crime, domestic abuse, and to ensure that as an organisation we're able to hold ourselves to the highest of standards. And I actually think, to go back to Dame Eilish Angelini's report, which you mentioned in your question from November 2020, since the highlight of some of those issues, which we were working against anyway, we've redoubled our efforts to ensure that we are tackling misogyny and improving sex equality across Police Scotland. We've done that in a number of ways. We've gone through a period similar to what you as a committee have done. We've listened and we've understood the experiences of the groups and individuals that that have been affected by some of these issues. We have set up an independent review group that's independently chaired and has members to provide advice, guidance, constructive criticism of policies, practices and actions that Police Scotland is taking at strategic and operational level. And in relation to tackling misogyny and sex equality directly, we've gone out very strongly as a public agency in terms of our leadership of ensuring that whilst this is an issue that affects women, men have a responsibility to stand up and challenge any behaviours where the respect and the equality that people should rightly expect on every occasion to be in place whilst they're at work and whilst they're providing a service to communities that, that have the faith in us to do that. If it's not there, you know, men need to be responsible for standing up and challenging that behaviour. We've done that internally, and we've done it very strongly externally and through, you know, personal leadership like myself. The Chief Constable has been very clear that men need to stand up and take responsibility for not only their own behaviour, but challenging that of the minority who choose not to behave to the standards and values of the organisation. And the final point, you talk about there being you know, a culture that's systemic across the organisation. I don't identify with that, but there are enough examples of it coming forward that we know there's a problem that we need to address to make sure that we're tackling it on each and every occasion where it arises. And I'm actually encouraged that the vast majority of those cases that are coming forward are being reported by colleagues who are saying this is not acceptable. And by the fact that we are addressing that, and as the leadership of the service is calling out very clearly, we expect people to let us know when they experience others behaving in a way that's not acceptable. I think we're getting more reports coming through, and that is a positive thing to ensure that we make sure there are none in the future. I mean, the final point is that this is a massive wider societal issue that doesn't start and finish with the police. And we are very keen to play our part in the leadership across society, as I've said, with some of the campaigning and public messaging we do across civic society as a national organisation. I think we're in a very strong position to do that and step up to that role. But I think others need to look within themselves as well. And the first way of doing that is to listen to the experiences of the people within your own organisation and understand what it's like for people who come from different perspectives and have experiences that you won't necessarily understand until you reach out and want to hear them.
Deputy Chief Constable, you said that I was using examples from outside of Scotland. I said that the Celia Everard case was a case which obviously was down south, but would erode women's confidence in the police. But there's many, many examples within Scotland, and I don't want I do want to draw you in this. If you're trying to suggest that this is a problem that doesn't exist in Scotland but exists elsewhere, I mean, I'm quite happy to put cases to you and to put some of a lot of the information from the media, I've got to say. I mean, for example, and you'll know it better than myself, the Channel 4, the Dispatches documentary Copstown Trial that was reported only in October, which was reporting that 166 police officers and special constables within Police Scotland have been accused of 245 counts of sexual misconduct. We can go through some of the Scottish examples. The reason I mentioned Sarah Everard was in terms of the saturation media coverage of that case and the details of that case erodes women's confidence in the police. But do you think that, are you trying to suggest that the problems that might exist down south in terms of, for example, domestic abuse are not of police officers, are not something that's a problem in Police Scotland? Because I have to say, I don't think, I'd like to know whether you're trying to suggest that you believe that you're in a better position in on these issues than, say, down south.
Can I perhaps come in, Katie, on that? I'm just very aware of time being tight, and we have the Cabinet Secretary waiting, and we've already pushed him back. So can I perhaps suggest, with members' agreement, that DCC Graham, if you could maybe follow up a response to Katie's question in writing, that would be helpful.
That's helpful. My main point is, does he believe there's a cultural problem?
I think if I could just add, convener, I don't think my previous answer in any way be as suggesting that there's not issues to be addressed in Scotland.
Thank you. That's very helpful.
Thanks very much. Okay. Thank you very much for that. And thank you, Katie, for your forbearance. And can I finally move on to hand over to Russell? I think you have a couple of questions around the Gender Recognition Act. So over to you, Russell.
Yes. Good morning, DCC Graham. It's been reported that Police Scotland may record rape as being committed by a woman when the alleged male-born rapist does not have a gender recognition certificate. How did the Police Scotland arrive at this decision?
DCC Graham, would you like to come in on that?
Yeah, I will do very briefly, convener. I'm conscious of time. You know, the sex and gender identification of individuals who come into contact with the police will be based on how they present or how they self-declare, which is entirely consistent with the values of our organisation. We don't require evidence or certification as proof of biological sex or gender identity other than a person's self-declaration, unless it's pertinent in investigating with which they're linked as a victim, witness or accused. I do appreciate the debate and some of the recent media publicity around about these complex issues has become extremely polarised. I do think in the scale of what we are dealing with, we've had 1,229 rapes reported to us in the first 6 months of this year. You know, that's nearly 47 rapes every week, nearly seven rapes reported every day. And there's never been a set of circumstances where we have had to do what you have suggested, where we would have somebody who has committed a rape in terms of the act of rape, who was biologically a man self-identifying as a woman. So at the moment, it's a hypothetical debate. I think if it was to happen, we would look very carefully at each set of circumstances. And we are awaiting clarity of Scottish Government guidance on this complex issue. And our desire is to ensure that the rights and equality interests of any individual, whether somebody who's from the trans community or indeed the hard and long fought for rights of women, are equally recognised. And I believe that that can be done in a way that doesn't have to be mutually exclusive.
Okay.
Russell, do you want to come back in?
Yes, please. For all that this hasn't happened yet, there's a possibility that it might, and this is what would then transpire. In such a situation, would a female victim be informed that the alleged rapist was choosing to identify as female?
In the eventuality that this set of circumstances were to arise, we would have to work very carefully through ensuring that these specific circumstances were addressed to ensure that everybody's rights were both respected and upheld. And as it's a situation that hasn't arisen yet, we haven't gone through that detailed planning. I go back to the point that I've made that the substantive issue here is the scale, prevalence and impact of sexual violence and domestic abuse in Scotland is enormous. A large proportion of what I have said in terms of figures already goes unreported to the police. And whilst this is clearly an important issue, I don't think it is the dominant issue that we need to address in terms of violence against women and girls across society today.
Okay. Convener, do I have time to go back to the line of questioning that Katie was on a moment ago, or are we out of time?
I'm afraid not. The Cabinet Secretary is, I know he's waiting to come in, and we've already overrun. So, as I said to Katie, I'm very happy for additional questions to be sent across to DCC Graham for a response. Okay, thanks very much. Okay, thank you for coming along today, DCC Graham and DCS Falls. I'm sorry it was rather rushed at the end, but thank you for your appearance. And obviously there are, I think, a number of questions that we will likely follow up in writing with you. So again, my thanks to you both, and we'll take a very short suspension to change over witnesses. Thank you. Thank you very much, and welcome back. I now welcome our second panel of witnesses this morning, and I'm very pleased to welcome Keith Brown, Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Veterans, and Mr. Willie Cowan, Deputy Director of the Criminal Justice Division. And again, can I please ask everybody committee to keep questions and answers as succinct as possible. I'm going to allow up to an hour for this panel, and I invite the Cabinet Secretary to make some brief opening remarks, and then we'll move on to questions. Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much, Convener. I'm once again grateful to the committee for the opportunity to meet today. I was going to make some remarks based on the areas that have been asked to cover by the clerks, and really it's with the intention of trying to help answer some questions which might help with timekeeping. First of all, the consequences of the COVID-19 pandemic, as we are all aware, have placed huge pressure on the criminal justice system and those who work within it. And we believe that our justice partners have worked incredibly hard and very creatively to adapt to the sustained and the complex challenges presented. And I want to put on record my gratitude to them for their efforts. The backlog in cases is one of the areas I've been asked to cover, and its impact on victims and the perception of justice can't be underestimated. The additional £50 million made available in this financial year, provided via the Recover, Renew and Transform programme, is being used to increase capacity across the justice system. And that includes additional recruitment of additional staff, greater use of digital tools and improved support for victims and witnesses. And that support has been extended into the next financial year, as outlined in the budget last week. The budget delivers over £3.1 billion for justice in 2022-23. Strengthening and reform are vital frontline services. That includes £188 million in additional investment, which amounts to around a 7% increase in recognition of the challenges that the pandemic has presented and those which it continues to present. That includes £40.5 million for the SPA, maintaining our commitment to the police resource budget in real terms each year for the entirety of this parliament. £9.5 million supporting the modernisation of Fire and Rescue Service. That includes investment to allow it to expand its work on fire prevention and fire safety with vulnerable households. £4 million for victim services, measures to tackle violence against women and girls, and support for the justice system to respond to victims' needs. So £53.2 million will also go for renewal and transformation of the justice sector. That includes court recovery, addressing trial backlogs and expanding community justice services. We are starting to see some signs of recovery. I welcome the additional 16 court capacity introduced from September, and the statistics from the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service appear to show a positive impact. There's obviously a long way to go, and like much of society, justice systems recovering from the pandemic will take time. Last month, I participated, as many of you did, I think, in a debate focused on men's violence against women and girls and their efforts to tackle the devastating impacts that that causes. Right at the centre of that discussion is the justice response to gender-based violence. Recently, I should tell the committee, I've been in discussions with the Chief Constable on the issue of spiking, despicable, cowardly act. From what we know, spiking is committed mainly by men, and we understand that victims are mostly women. Yet another example of the disproportionate impact on women by men's offending. I'm reassured that our legislation on this matter is robust, and that Police Scotland are actively pursuing every single report of spiking, and they've established a gold command on this area specifically. And last week, I convened the second round table with justice partners, health and education, and the nighttime economy sector to further discuss the issue. And I'm very reassured by the concerted efforts of our cross-sector partners to better understand the problem and to take appropriate measures to address spiking. That will include development of standard reporting, protocols, consistent messaging and training to raise awareness, and investigation into the use of drug testing for strips, drug testing strips for drinks. I'm keen to ensure that preventative approach continues through our equally safe strategy and Police Scotland's own strategic approach to investigating and preventing these issues. I announced after careful consideration that we'll now move forward with the immediate establishment of the Scottish Government-led governance group, which comprises of key stakeholder interests, to enable progress and detailed consideration of the individual and collective recommendations in Lord Justice Clark's review group report on improving the management of sexual offence cases. And in coming to that determination, very much of the mind that what is required is a whole system approach to both consideration and delivery. Whilst the recommendation to provide complainers in sexual offences with a lifelong right to anonymity is freestanding, and we have committed to legislate to give effect to it in this parliament, Many of the recommendations cross multiple interests, and it's self-evident that given the many dependencies, we will require support of key partners in order to deliver that change. That much, I think, has come through from the evidence you just heard from the police as well. I think it's important to reflect that the report was the product of a cross-justice review group. We recognise that ownership, responsibility and delivery rests with us all. I have expectations that the group will move at pace, with the first meeting of the group taking place next week, with an equal focus on ensuring recognition is taken of wider and related Scottish Government initiatives. And we all recognise that the report has potential to drive transformational change, if we can get this right, across the system and also beyond sexual offence cases. There is a great deal of cross-sector consensus, as demonstrated by several statements of support at publication. It's my view that the recommendations can be utilised as a catalyst for whole system transformation. That's the intention. I appreciate the committee is keen to see progress on the recommendations. However, it's also true to say that given the complexity of the potential changes proposed, careful consideration is essential, and I would assure the committee that I consider the recommendations a priority. Looking to next year, we'll hold a consultation on sexual offences and victims' rights in the spring, which will cover many of the recommendations. Some of these can be pursued now, and we've supported the two-year pilot project to visually record rape complainers' police statements, which you've heard about, which was named in Lady Dorian's report. Working closely with Police Scotland, Crown Office and Rape Crisis Scotland, we've enabled this initiative to become a reality in Edinburgh, in Highland and Elms and in Dumfries and Galloway. And as at the 12th of December 2021, 266 VRIs have been carried out with a total of 247 complainers. However, no cases have proceeded to trial, so we don't have the data throughput for evaluation purposes. We want the initiative, as the police do, to be available across the whole of Scotland in the future, and we have secured collective agreement to start preparing to scale this up beyond the pilot. There is a clear direction to move as fast as we can without compromising the training and the skill required of those delivering this for court use. And the Courts and Tribunal Service led the RRT workstream, which championed the introduction of virtual summary trials, working closely with the third sector, who were enthusiastic supporters of this innovation. I met last week with Sheriff Principal Pyle and look forward to receiving his anticipated report from the Virtual Trials National Project Board and to consider next steps. On Monday, we launched a consultation on the not proven verdict, as you'll know, convener, and related reforms, importantly, in recognition of what we believe is a strong case being put forward for its abolition. But they are complex issues, and many stakeholders have principled objections to a move to a two verdicts situation, or they have highlighted the interconnectedness of the system, including the potential interaction with the jury majority, so we have to consider these issues carefully. As we discussed at the recent cross-party roundtable, as a government, we take very seriously the concerns some stakeholders have with how the corroboration rule can affect access to justice for survivors of crimes committed in private, and therefore there are questions on this matter contained within that consultation as well. And we are committed to ensuring victims' rights are at the centre of our justice system. We've invested £88 million over the past 5 years in victim services. We recently announced details of a new victim-centred approach fund worth at least £30 million over 3 years, which will provide support to victims' organisations across Scotland, and we are working closely with victims and support organisations to scope out the role of the new Victims Commissioner. Furthermore, we've already strengthened the Victim Notification Scheme. We're committed to undertaking a detailed review early next year. So there is much to do. My colleague Ash Reagan will be taking forward a strategic longer-term evidence-based assessment of the totality of the experience of women in relation to the justice system, with a view to understanding where innovation, better data collection and learning, perhaps from different jurisdictions, could help reform or redesign aspects of it to better meet women's needs. And over recent months, in collaboration with our justice partners, we've been developing a new justice strategy for Scotland. So in the new year, I'll set out a new vision for justice and take forward what I believe will be transformative action in this parliamentary term and beyond. And as we emerge from the pandemic, it's right that we should look at how we renew our public services, build on the lessons that we've learnt, both on the progress made and the opportunities that might be there to provide greater resilience in critical services. And we have to continue to be steadfast in our zero tolerance of men's violence against women and girls and the relentless challenge, the spectrum of behaviours that enable it. So with that, convener, happy to take your questions.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. I appreciate these comprehensive opening comments. Before we move into questions, again, can I remind members and our witnesses to keep questions and answers as succinct as possible. And if I may, Cabinet Secretary, just kick things off with a general question relating to your recent announcement regarding the establishment of the governance group to progress the detailed consideration of the Lord Justice Clerk's recommendations. So I wonder if I can just ask you to outline a little bit more detail around the remit and the timetable for the work of the governance group, in particular how you will ensure that the work of the group isn't a sort of duplication, if you like, of the review that's already taken place, and rather that it focuses on making real progress on the recommendations and to take them forward.
Thanks for that. You'll have seen in the letter that I sent to the Lord Justice General, which I copied to yourself and the committee, the draft remit of the governance group. And I expect that this will be finalised when it meets, as I've said, next week. I can provide some details. Well, if I can provide the correspondence to the members of the committee, if you're already happy to do that. But the discussion next week will also include the work plan, the timetable, the identification of any working groups which the governance group itself wants to set up, look at specific areas covered in the report. You'll know the breadth of the report already. The committee will be very aware that we have a very public timetable commitment, as outlined in the programme for government, to legislate in this session of Parliament for a statutory right to anonymity, lifelong anonymity for complainers in sexual offence cases, and also to giving serious consideration to the other recommendations of the Dorian Review, including the potential introduction of specialist courts and what the implications of that would be. I've already said that I expect that the group will work at pace and that they provide regular updates to the Criminal Justice Board and the Lord Justice Clerk's Review Group. And I would also expect, of course, that the committee will be kept fully up to date. And one final thing to say, Convener, because your question touched on the idea of duplication. I mentioned that we have this week initiated the consultation Not Proven, which has a number of related issues, size of majority and so on, size of jury and the majority required for a conviction. I think many of the Lady Dorian's recommendations, a number of which would require legislation to take them through, start to come in at that point once we've had that consultation and when we have a way forward. I think they are not of a piece, but certainly they are very interrelated. So we'd want to try and take those through at concert, which might give you in concert, which might give you an idea of the kind of timetable that we're looking towards. But it's also true to say, and I say this just now because I'm sure it will come up again, we have around 22 different pieces of legislation to take through that we know of. And there'll be others may want to bring forward. So it's a crowded landscape. We can't do it all at once, and we are trying to do some of these things as quickly as we possibly can, but taking the due time to consider them properly.
Thanks very much, Cabinet Secretary. Just in the spirit of letting members come in with more questions, I'll hand over to Katie Clark and then Rona Mackay, who I think have some follow-up questions around the governance group. Katie.
Yes, and I think the Minister has answered some of what I was going to ask already, so thank you. But what I would be interested in is to what extent it's been possible to implement any of Lady Dorian's recommendations already. You've outlined, I think, the timetable going forward, but to what extent is there already implementation of some of the recommendations?
You're right, we have produced one thematic report already which have detailed a number of either 11 or 14, I can't remember exactly which we, you're right, we can take forward right away. There's another tranche which we are also taking forward right away, which don't require legislation, and we'll continue to do that. Some of them are for other agencies like the police, and they will take their time to come through with what they're doing as well. But the governance arrangements in place already before the governance group establishes has looked at this. And there is progress being made already where it's possible to do that, but perhaps Willie Cowan can give you more detail on that.
That would be really helpful. Thank you.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Yes, so I myself will be chairing this governance group, And we fully recognise that it is a joint endeavour. As the Cabinet Secretary said in his opening remarks, this is a whole system approach to pretty transformational change. So one of the first issues for us next week is to establish the work programme, as the Cabinet Secretary says. There are various aspects of Lady Dorian's report which might be described as policy, practice and culture, which can be progressed at individual organisational level and as a system as a whole. But there are also aspects of the report which could require legislation to deliver. And I suppose that there's a third aspect here that the group will want to consider, which is, are there any aspects which technically don't require legislation to deliver but might benefit from an underpinning of that legislation? So, whilst I don't want to prejudge what the work programme will look like following the meeting of the governance group next week, I think we are all quite clear. I think from the evidence that you received last week from David Fraser and Danielle McLaughlin from the Court Service, and Danielle is heading up the team in the Court Service taking forward Lady Dorian's work, that there is active consideration and work going on about what can be worked on, developed and implemented now, at the same time as policy consideration towards a consultation towards legislation is being considered as outlined by the Cabinet Secretary.
And is there any of the recommendations that you believe have already been implemented? Is there any particular reason why there's been a delay up till now in terms of any recommendations that could already be implemented, maybe have already been implemented?
Yeah, some of the thinking and development work has been done, but the actual implementation has yet to move forward at pace. And I think chunks of that come down to a couple of major issues. A lot of the people who will be involved in this have been involved in the frontline recovery work for COVID and addressing the backlogs. And also, a lot of the people involved in this have also been involved in the work leading up to and during COP26. So, what we are hoping for, as of now, as of the establishment of the governance group, is that we collectively will be able to take forward this work at pace, and the work that the recommendations that can be developed and implemented without legislation can move forward. In parallel, as I say, with the policy development for those aspects which could require legislation.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks. Katie, anything else from yourself? If not, I'll bring in Rona. No. Okay, I'll hand over to Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Yes, I'd like to ask you about an aspect of the specialist courts that you know that one of the Lady Dorian's recommendations, and you referenced it last week. The SCTS told us they didn't envisage any specialist training for jurors in this court. Can I ask what your view is on this, and given the nature of the court in general and the need for trauma informed practice, do you think that there should be, and if there should be, how practically could this be done?
Thanks for the question. If I can be a little bit cagey on this, just to say that when the proposals to change the courts, the decisions on it rest with the judiciary and not with me. And I think we would tend to wait to see how the judiciary is approaching a particular issue, for example, the establishment of specialist courts, before becoming too involved. So that's why we are. Given that Lady Dorian has made this one of her recommendations, it's easier for us to talk about that now. It's not us being seen to try and determine how the court system should run. And also, I think it's true to say the governance group will look at this issue starting from next week. But my own view is that, and I would especially not want to talk about how we might treat jurors. I think, again, that's for the judiciary to talk about. However, your point about trauma-informed approaches, I think, is a really important one. And the point I was trying to make earlier on is that, in addition to all the different pieces of legislation, what I hope to see achieved is an entire end-to-end justice system which is both trauma-informed and victim-centred. I think these things can be in danger of becoming buzzwords that people just throw around. So the real challenge is to see how it makes how we can make that real. So some of the training that we're undertaking with the NHS to try and make sure this happens. We had a very good discussion on this at the Victims Task Force recently. And if we can get to the stage where the different elements of the system, and I call it a system, but there are areas which I know that you are aware of, for example, to do with the judiciary and the courts, which are quite distinct and independent. Also with the police, they have an independent role in many respects of ministers. But we have to have an end-to-end process where it's victim-centred. We're focused on people who've suffered crimes, and it's trauma-informed. And I'll give you just one example, and it's not the one that you've asked about, because I've explained why I don't want to go into too much detail. But one of the survivors, the chap wasn't a victim, he was the father of somebody who was murdered, and said when he had to go to court and sit a couple of feet away from the family of the person who was accused of murdering his son, it just felt off to him in so many ways. So I think the justice system has been very focused on trying to get, if you like, justice delivered. It's got to feature much more in its thinking around how victims are treated and to be trauma-informed. So I have a general support for the idea of people being trauma-informed, but it wouldn't be for me to say the jurors should be trained or given background kind of information.
Thank you. Thanks. I understand that. Thanks very much. Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thank you very much indeed. I'm now going to bring in Russell Finlay just to kick off with some questioning around reporting and recording. Russell?
Yeah, good morning, Mr Brown. Now, we've already heard from Police Scotland this morning confirmation that they may record rape as being committed by a woman when the alleged male-born rapist does not have a gender recognition certificate. There are many concerns about this, not least that it could corrupt crime statistics, and you've already spoken in your opening remarks about the importance of data collection being accurate. The former SNP Justice Secretary calls this a legal absurdity. Do you agree with him?
From DC Malcolm Graham, when I think he pointed out that there hadn't been a single case of the type that's been mentioned, despite the fact, I think he said there'd been 1,129, if I've got the figure correct, rape cases in the first six months of this year, which is a horrendous figure, in which we're trying to deal with through some of the reforms that I've mentioned. And he said there hadn't been a single case of the type which you mentioned. But I think what he did say was that the police's approach, and the police will in many cases be the ones that do the data collection in relation to this, although you're quite right to suggest the government will have interest and a view on that as well. It's important that the police take the human rights approach. And I think making sure the rights of everybody involved are observed and respected and upheld, which is what DC Graham said, and also that the safety of everybody involved is upheld as well. I think that's the right approach that the police have taken. So I'll be very supportive of comments made by DC Graham.
I didn't actually catch the beginning of your answer. I don't know if it's a tech problem, but do you therefore not agree with your predecessor, Mr McCaskill?
I haven't seen Mr McCaskill's views. I'm much more inclined to take the up-to-date positions presented by the DCC that you heard from in the previous evidence session.
Well, one question I asked of Mr Graham was whether a rape victim would be informed if indeed this did transpire, and I understand it has not yet happened, but that may just be because this is a new development and it's clearly causing significant concern to women across Scotland. How do you think a woman who had been raped would feel if they found her attacker had been categorised as a woman by Police Scotland?
Well, I think what I think is important is that the police do respect the rights of everybody in the situation. And it's not just a cliche to say that Police Scotland are very much, as they were at COP26 and in various other respects, very focused on human rights. So I think they should try and uphold the rights, as DCC Malcolm Graham said, of everybody involved. But you say it's a new situation. I'm not sure that it is a new situation. I'm not sure what new situation you're referring to. This has been a feature, or people, trans people have been a feature of the justice system for a long time. And I think the police dealt with it in the right way, as DCC Graham suggested. So, and just in case there's any confusion, there's nothing, of course, in terms of the Gender Recognition Act, which should impinge in this area. There's nothing in the proposed gender recognition reform which proposes any changes to crime recording. But I do think that the proportionate approach of the police, when they mentioned 1,129 rape cases in the first 6 months and not one falling into the category that you mentioned, I think the approach that they're taking is the right one.
Just a quick clarification. What I meant by new was the recent confirmation from Police Scotland that this is indeed how it could be applied. But thank you.
Okay, I'll just come back to one point that the member raises, because he mentioned about the response he'd received from the ECC about notification for a victim. And I think the Deputy Chief Counsel's response says they haven't had that situation arise yet, but they would have to look at that. And I think that is the right approach to take. And that is consistent with looking at the rights of victims, making sure that public safety and human rights are at the forefront. So you're right to say, of course, they have not encountered this yet, but they will have to give some thought as to how they deal with that. And I would support the police in doing so.
Sure. And while this is largely theoretical, if you follow this to its logical conclusion, you may have rape victims in court having to call their alleged rapist she.
But again, the court system is something that I don't control. It's the justice system, the judiciary and the Scottish court system that deal with that. All I would say is that whether it's a court system, whether it's a prison system or whether it's a police, I think from all the evidence I've seen, and I've looked at this in some detail, they are very cognizant of the rights of individuals and also the safety of individuals. And they are trying extremely hard to make sure those are upheld, and I support them in that process.
Thank you.
Thanks very much. I think Pauline McNeill would like to come in on this topic, and briefly, if you would, Pauline. Thanks.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. I'm not going to draw you into a policy discussion this morning on this. I just wanted to get some clarity. I think, according to the reports, I think we need to be clear that what we're talking about here, I understand it, is not a trans person per se, but where an alleged crime is, where they present for the purposes of the crime, is my understanding of what Police Scotland have said. So I just think there needs to be clarity over that. That's the way the Times have reported it, is if the accused person then presents as a woman, that Police Scotland would seem to protect that and not someone who previously identified. So there needs to be clarity over that, but I'm not drawing you into that today. But what the Deputy Chief Constable did say was that the Scottish Government was going to provide clarity over that. And I wasn't sure what the Deputy Chief Constable meant by that. Did he mean that you're having ongoing discussions? It's just an answer to that. Is there ongoing discussions, or does he mean the Gender Reform Act or something else? That's only, I wanted an answer of what he meant, if you could tell the committee. Thanks.
I'm afraid I can't tell you what the Chief Constable meant. Like you, I think maybe he was talking about when he moved forward with the gender recognition. That may be the most obvious thing to say that he meant. I don't know, and I'm happy to, well, he'll probably, or the police will be watching this, not in any sinister way, and I'm sure they can provide a response. But I would say it's just this, that I think they are aware, as you're hinting at, of the complexities of this and the dangers in this situation. And I think, having looked at this, the approach they take, I think the same is true of the prison service, is a very sensitive one. And they are sensitive to both the human rights of people involved and also the safety of those involved. But your basic point of, which I think is somebody trying to use the system in some way, I think they're very well aware of that. But they're also aware of the individual rights of people. So, in any event, it may be for DCC Graham to come back and clarify exactly what he meant by his comments, rather than for me to say.
If I just could just finish by just asking the Cabinet Secretary to read the press release from Police Scotland after today, because the press release implies, you can see it in the Times article, that anyone who presents, and maybe they didn't mean to say that, but maybe that's something you want to discuss with them. Thank you very much.
Thanks very much, Pauline. I'd like to move things on, if I may, to some questions around the introduction of a specialist court. And Pauline, I can come back to you on this and then move across to Jamie Green. So, Pauline?
Thank you. Cabinet Secretary, we had a bit of a really interesting and good exchange with David Fraser last week on what a specialist court is. So my question is, I mean, are you satisfied that in legislating to create a specialist court, which I understand you have to do, it wouldn't look like we were downgrading sexual offences? Because on one view of what we've been told is it will be part of the High Court, but we do need to legislate to create a specialist court. And I think that's a bit unclear, because I think that I'm right in saying the bench is about 32, 35 judges who deal with rape every day, I would have thought, in their daily cases. So I think we need some clarity about why we need a specialist court and what the specialist court would do. I can see the case for a court which treats victims differently, and we've heard, you know, evidence about trauma that victims experience going to courts which are not equipped, you know, space-wise, so that they can enter the building without coming across the person that they have accused of a crime. So I just wondered if you could provide any clarity around that. Do you share any concerns that legislating for a specialist court might look like? Because, of course, it's only a 10-year sentence might look like we've downgraded sexual offences.
Yeah, it's a very good question, and it may be useful to hear from Ollie Cowan in relation to this. And it will be the case the governance group will look at this issue. And also, I think there is a particular issue around where, for example, a court might be looking at domestic abuse, but rape is part of what they're looking at that time as well, and where does that properly sit? The Lord Advocate, as you know, has, and I know that you're going to speak to the Lord Advocate next week, has talked about how we can get the pace to address the backlog. There's a huge issue, and part of the issue of the backlog is to do with the impact it's having on victims and witnesses, and given the preponderance of sexual assault and rape cases in the backlog, that's why we want to try and deal with it. So that's, I think, one of the drivers for the specialist courts. However, it's also true to say, as you will know as well, I'm sure, that the Faculty of Advocates, the Law Society, the Bar Association have expressed concerns about some of these proposals. That's more to do with judge-only trials, sorry. But it's also true to say that specialist courts and the proposal for judge-only trials, or the latter at least, was one area where there was no consensus when Lady Dorian's group looked at this. So these are things which have to be given more thought in the governance group. And of course, it is the case that whatever we chose to do, Parliament will get the chance. We'll have to legislate if we're going to do specialist courts in any event. Parliament will get the chance to say, but it might be worth hearing from Ollie Cowan on some of that detail as well, if that's okay, Convener.
Thanks. Mr. Cowan, would you like to come in?
Yeah, absolutely, Convener. Thank you. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I think Ms. McNeill raises a hugely valid point, that sexual offences are particularly heinous crime, and how they are viewed by the public is important. The Lady Dorian set out her, or the Lady Dorian's group set out her recommendations on why she thought specialist court could add to the, I hesitate to say positive experience of victims in the justice system, but it's to improve the way that the victims experience the justice system. So one of the key aspects of the governance group and the subsequent policy development and consultation which will follow will be exactly that. So Lady Dorian recommends 10 years for the sentencing judge in the specialist court, which I think David Fraser referenced last week, would cover about 90 over the high 90% of sentencing in relation to sexual offence cases at the moment. So my take on Lady Dorian's report and her recommendations, and I was on the early part of the group before moving to do some COVID work, was that far from downgrading sexual offences, the specialist court would take due cognizance of the particular experiences of people caught up in those types of offences. There is a question around about how we would transition from rape cases being automatically heard in the High Court to how sexual offences in the round, including rape cases, could be heard in a specialist court. But I think, as the Cabinet Secretary says, one of the potential complications around all of this, which would be for the Lord Advocate to consider in terms of the subsequent marking decisions in individual cases, is what is the mix of offences within any particular case, which would either divert or not, would point it towards a specialist court or point it maybe towards the High Court. So, for example, rape and attempted murder, I suspect, although I hesitate to speak for the Lord Advocate, but I suspect that that would be considered from the High Court as opposed to the specialist court, whereas a sexual assault without the additional attempted murder or that additional violence would be considered more appropriate for the specialist court. But I acknowledge that there are concerns out there. Cabinet Secretary's outlined concerns from some groups, and we will need to work through that with the governance group towards, as I say, consultation to bring forward a proposition that will be considered both by public from the consultation and subsequently by Parliament if Government brings forward that draft legislation.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much indeed. Can I bring in Jamie Green, followed by Kitty Clark, on this issue?
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary and guests. I think the question really is around specialist courts, is whether they are instead of or as well as existing infrastructure. And I think that is a fundamental issue, which I think is still unclear, is what would you be taking away from other court mechanisms to specialise in these dedicated courts, or whether or not we would simply be adding to the capacity of the courts in order to clear the background. And we do need to clear the background, nobody disagrees with that. But each of those creates, I think, its own set of very different issues. And I think that's really what the committee is struggling with, is there was a very top level recommendation from Lady Dorian, which seems to, you know, have a lot of positive elements to it in terms of the trauma-informed aspect. However, I think the devil was in the details. So can I just ask Cabinet Secretary how the government might present that back to the committee and to Parliament so that we can work through some of that detail so that we understand, because clearly there are going to be financial and resource issues around how any such specialist courts might work in future.
Yeah, I think though I have to be honest and say this is central to how the court systems run, and as such is a decision ultimately for the judiciary. But Jimmy Green's right to say it's going to have implications. So, for example, in relation to sentencing, if you want to, I do understand the point that you don't want to have court systems tripping over each other or cutting across each other. But I think what is intended, and it's not for me to speak for the Lord Justice Clerk, but I think what she intends here is that both the specialist court will be able to build up a body of experience, as Pauline Neil referred to, that you currently have in the High Court with frequency of dealing with the same issues. Also there'll be an efficiency in that as well, which might help to deal with the backlog. But I really do hesitate to come in and say much more as to how those potential duplications or crossovers might be detrimental. It's really for the for Lady Dorian and the judiciary to say. However, Willie Cowan, as I've mentioned, is on the group which will look at this, the governance group will look at this, and the government, for our part, and I know this maybe only partially answers the question, stand ready to help, whether it's in terms of legislation required and sentencing powers, or, as Jamie Green suggests, in terms of resources, fund what the judiciary eventually believe. I think they expect to report next year further on this. So there are likely to be resource implications if there's a change. And I would hope and I would expect that the Lord Justice would be well aware of any potential problems from duplication or overlap.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you for that. And I think not just the resource implication for the SCTS or the Crown, but also for the defence sector as well. We obviously have to ensure that there's sufficient resource to ensure that people are represented if there are more cases running per day than currently run, for example. I guess perhaps we could take some learning from the, or I would hope we could take some learning from the integrated domestic abuse courts. I wondered if you could share any more on that, because clearly that's, you know, the concept of a specialist court is not a new one, in the sense that we accept that if a large amount of crimes are of a similar nature, then they could be dealt with in a similar way, for example, in a central place. So that, you know, this isn't a new concept, but I wondered, you know, what has been the feedback from the domestic abuse courts, from either the faculty, the Law Society, from the police, from victims' organisations or the third sector themselves, who've obviously had to interact with that specialist court in the past, and whether there's any learnings, positive or otherwise, that might come from that?
It's a good question, and we're not probably yet fully ready to answer it completely, but just for backgrounds, so we're working with Police Scotland's Crown Office, Rape Crisis Scotland and so on, which have all been involved in developing this domestic abuse course. So far in Edinburgh, Highlands and Islands and Dumfries and Galloway, and just to say the evaluation of that has still to be undertaken. So earlier this year, Crown Office stats showed the number of charges related to domestic abuse last year was the highest since 2015-2016. Just give me one second, I'll have more detail on that if I can just leave it to hand. So it's probably important to reflect that specialist courts, as mentioned again, are for the judiciary to consider. Where they indicate a willingness to progress specialist courts, such as Lady Dorian, we would consider what may be needed. But specifically on domestic abuse, there are areas where these courts operate. There are also areas where there are ad hoc domestic abuse cases, and they are all operational decisions for the Scottish courts. The first full 3 years of operation of the new domestic offence, which you'll be aware of, will complete on the 31st of March, which triggers a need for a statutory report to be published by the government detailing both the qualitative and quantitative information about the operation of the new offence and experience of victims. That's probably going to be the most useful publication I can think to answer Jamie Green's question, but his point about has there been feedback informally from these different partners, maybe Willie Cowan would be able to come back on that.
Yes, thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Yeah, I think that there is broad support for specialist courts and the build-up of experience of all the practitioners, be that defence, prosecution, court service and third sector support organisations. As the Cabinet Secretary says, the concept, and as Mr Green has said, the concept of a specialist court is not new. The difference with Lady Dorian's recommendation is that we would require some legislation to enable that specialist court to be put into place, whereas with domestic abuse courts and perhaps drugs courts and the like, those can be put into place at the behest of SCTS and the Lord President within the existing legislative framework.
That's fine. I'm happy to leave it there, Convener.
Thanks very much. Can I bring in Katie Clark now, and then I'll bring in Fulton McGregor to ask some questions around use of recorded police interviews. Katie.
Thank you. And I think from what Mr Cowan has said, it's likely that the Procurator Fiscal would have, or the Crown would have, criteria for referral in terms of whether a case, a rape case or other sexual offence case, would go to the High Court or would go to the Specialist Court. But to go back to this issue of downgrading, I think that the concern is if there's a cap on sentencing for the Specialist Court at 10 years, then that makes it look like a lower court, in the same way as at the moment the Sheriff Court has a range of disposals, and if a sentence that's longer than within the Sheriff Court's powers, it gets, you know, the sentencing aspects get referred to the High Court. And I understand the thinking is that that's how the Specialist Court would operate, that even though it's a High Court judge that's sitting in the Specialist Court, they would only be able to sentence 10 years. And if they wished to, or they thought it might be appropriate, to sentence for more than 10 years, it would be have to be referred to the High Court. Now, is that the kind of issue that the governance court, the governance group will look at in terms of, you know, whether they're going to have that sentencing cap or whether the specialist court will have the full range of disposals? Is that still a live issue, if I could ask the Cabinet Secretary?
I think it has to be. The governance group will decide what the governance group is going to look at, but I think you make a very reasonable point. And so the referral to the High Court in a situation where the specialist court doesn't think it has a required sentencing powers is a duplication of what happens just now in other spheres. But your basic point, I think, is about ensuring there's not either confusion or overlap or duplication. And I think, knowing the people on the governance review group, not least Willie Cowan, but you can mention the others, that they will have that in their minds. It's not in anybody's interest, especially when we're in the context of the backlog that we've got, for us to duplicate anything. We want to try and make it as efficient as possible, at the same time as making sure that both justice is delivered, but it's done in a trauma-informed and victim-centred way. So I think that they will be considering that. But again, Willie, he'll tell you as well that it may be the group will set up different working groups to look at different aspects, and it may be this is one of them, but that will be for the group to decide. I don't know if Willie wants that.
I'd be interested to hear from Mr Cowan. I mean, in particular, the issue obviously is that the High Court's a higher court than the Sheriff Court, and we wouldn't want there to be an impression that the Specialist Court was a lesser court than the High Court. I think that my understanding is it would be, depending obviously how the legislation is constructed, it would effectively be a part of the High Court, but a specialist part. Is that fair? I mean, obviously it depends how decisions are made in terms of how the legislation will be brought forward. Would Mr Cowan like to come in on that?
Absolutely. I think this is one of the key aspects of the governance group discussion, which will then lead to consultation. So what we have is Lady Dorian's group makes a recommendation. The recommendation is a specialist court with 10 years on the basis that, as I said before, the high 90% of existing sexual offence convictions fall within that 10-year bracket. Now, the governance group will need to consider the advice that it wants to put forward to government, and government will need to consider the basis upon which it would want to consult. But I think if you take the report as read, the government may decide to consult exactly on the basis of Lady Dorian's recommendation that a specialist court is set up that has a 10-year sentencing power. It is then, in the same way, for every consultation, for every legislation, for interested parties to respond to that consultation, and for government to then take account of the evidence which comes before it, before bringing a final proposition to Parliament. So I think there are a couple of steps. I absolutely understand, and I've had the same feedback from many sources that I deal with day and daily, that perception, that optic, is quite difficult for some people, and that's something that both the governance group and the government in due course are going to have to consider carefully.
Yeah, and could I just a sort of further point in terms of the court establishment? I mean, when you listen to victims of sexual offences, the physical process of going to court can be very, very traumatic. And Cabinet Secretary, you've already referred to the family of a murder victim having to sit in a court with the accused. And is it envisaged that these new specialist courts would have separate facilities, which obviously have got big resource implications? I mean, you know, at the moment we're developing facilities such as Inverness in terms of, you know, witness suites, etc. So is it envisaged that there will be significant resource implications of these specialist courts, in that they would have separate facilities that would be designed in a different way, or is it envisaged that they would continue to operate within the current court estate? Are these things that are going to have to be discussed?
No. Cabinet Secretary, do you want me to respond?
Well, can I just say first before you do, Willie, and hopefully we're going to say the same thing here, which would be good. The basic point which Katie Clarke makes is an important one. So I mentioned before to committee about forensic medical examination suites, which we're trying to roll out across the country, which are a very different experience for those that have been traumatised by sexual offences and the way that they are initially treated and dealt with. And I mentioned, of course, that the court physical infrastructure just now is of a different time. I'm not going to pretend that we can completely recast the physical built infrastructure of the entire justice system overnight, and we certainly can't do that. We can't hold back dealing with the backlog until we do that. So I think we just want to make sure that wherever we are making changes, and I can't assume what the specialist courts proposals will end up looking like from the judiciary and what we'll be asked in relation to it. We want to try and ensure at every opportunity how we can push through that trauma-informed nature. And although I mentioned that case, which I did, it's also true there's a very large public demand to have court proceedings done in public, transparently, with everybody there. So there are different pressures that apply there, but we are trying, as is evidenced by some of the stuff we've done already, so giving evidence by commission, video recorded interviews, forensic medical examinations, we are trying to make it as victim-centred as we can. I don't know if you want to add to that, Willie.
I think you've covered the bases, Cabinet Secretary. I think that the general point here, and this goes back to your opening statement, is that this is a system-level approach, and Lady Dorian's report looks at the system end-to-end. So, as the Cabinet Secretary has touched on there, evidence by commission, where victims give evidence and get cross-examined, away from the court in a private setting, and we've invested in Glasgow, and we've touched on Inverness, and we're looking at other areas. So the whole concept of, as in Lady Dorian's report and as touched on by DCC Graham, of having the initial interview VRI'd, that then being the primary source of the evidence of the case, if necessary, and a follow-up of evidence by commission in advance of the court case. So the intention of that flow is that the victim may never require to attend the final trial to give evidence, either in person or remotely. And I think the other thing to bear in mind is that vulnerable witnesses already have the right to give evidence either behind screens and with protections, or indeed from a remote location. So I think that the whole drive of this is to reduce the drama, to have the victim give their evidence as early as possible, and that is only revisited for specific issues, and they're not re-traumatised by revisiting at various parts of the system. We already know, and we've invested in the facilities to improve evidence by commission, and we know that if we're going to do that for VRI and we're going to increase evidence by commission, then the infrastructure to enable that will require investment. But I think the key thing all the way through this is trauma-informed, person-centred, that the victim gives evidence at an appropriate place, is not re-traumatised, and wherever possible, the whole system of giving evidence means that the individual doesn't need to attend the trial.
That's helpful, thank you. And finally, and briefly, could I ask?
I wonder, Katie, if I can maybe just come in.
Of course.
I'm sorry to cut you off. It's just there are a couple of other areas for questioning that I would very much like to bring in before we close the session at 10:02. So if I may just come in and ask a couple of questions around independent legal representation, which I think you covered off in your opening statement, Cabinet Secretary. In the testimony that we took in private from survivors, many of them said that they felt that their voice wasn't heard in court, whereas they felt that the accused's voice was. And of course, Section 275 of the Criminal Procedure Act means that particularly intimate and sensitive information about a complainer can be used in the court. So I'm just wondering what your views are on victims of sexual assault and rape having access to legal representation? And do you think that that could also be extended to domestic abuse victims?
And I hate to preface my answer with the same point, which is that this will be a matter for the courts as to how they run the system. But you're right to say Lady Dorian's made this as a recommendation, and we will give careful consideration to both to the ongoing research in relation to this issue and to her recommendation. We are clear that there should be restrictions in the use of sexual history evidence, with the court having, as always, a critical role in deciding whether to allow such evidence in any given case. There are safeguards in Scots law, as you'll know, which mean the court must give explicit approval for character and past behaviour evidence to be used in sexual offences cases. And you might know as well, Convener, that we hosted a round table in November 2020 before either of us were doing these jobs on the safeguarding of privacy rights for sexual offence victims and perceived barriers them coming forward to report crimes against them. And I think we have to also make sure that complainers are aware of their rights, which has been an issue. I think you've some of the evidence from your previous sessions, which was covered in the previous evidence session today, from some of the victims that you heard from, I think highlight this point as well. We have to make sure that they are aware of their rights, and we look forward to receiving further information on the proposal for the Scottish Legal Aid Board funded pilot project as well. So, that's not to say definitively, because we'll wait and see how Lady Dorian's recommendation is taken forward in the governance group, but there are important safeguards there now. We have to make sure that people are aware of how their rights can be safeguarded to a greater extent than is currently the case.
Thanks very much. And yeah, this is certainly an issue that I'll be interested in watching closely as it develops. We've just really got time for one more question. And I'm going to bring in Rona Mackay to cover off the option to pilot a single judge rape trial option. So, Rona, over to you.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, as you say, we heard in evidence from survivors that they got the impression sometimes that juries hadn't fully understand the sort of legal implications of what was going on, the legal process, and we also heard that there could have been a perception of unconscious prejudice surrounding the case. For example, if the complainer had been drinking, or the way she was dressed, or whatever, and many victims groups are in support of the single judge trials, but I know that it's split within the legal profession. I just wondered what your view was on this, and what kind of circumstances would you think that this could apply to?
Well, first of all, as you say, you have that recommendation from Lady Dorian. I know the committee's heard from Lord Advocate in relation to this as well, and I think one of her main concerns is about how this might help impact the backlog in a positive way. But there's also other factors, as you've mentioned, which is the specialist nature of the knowledge of the judge themselves. So I think we would want to see how this is taken forward through the governance review group. I know that's not giving you a definitive answer just now, but we are mindful of the fact this raises serious concerns on the part of different groups. Some political parties, some people on your committee as well, have serious concerns, as would the Faculty of Advocates, the Law Society and others within the system, who say that they think there's no widespread support for such a view. And that's probably reflected in the fact that the review group itself, Lady Dorian's review group, couldn't come to a consensus on this. So it will be part of the work of the governance review group. There is no way it would ever be proceeded with without full parliamentary involvement, to the extent that that's necessarily appropriate. But I think we have to wait and see what the governance review group comes up with.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thank you very much. Cabinet Secretary, thank you very much for your time this morning. Very much appreciated, as ever. We've run out of time, and appreciate your forbearance in letting us run over a little bit, and also Mr Cowan as well. There are some other questions that we would have liked to have asked. However, we will likely follow up in writing with you. So again, my thanks to you both, and we'll now take a short suspension before we move on to the next agenda item. Thank you. Welcome back, everybody. Our next item of business this morning is consideration of two legislative consent memoranda. Firstly, the Police Crime Sentencing and Courts Bill and the Judicial Review and Courts Bill. And I'm pleased to welcome back the Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Veterans and also two of his officials, Mr. Phil Lamont of the Criminal Justice Division and Ms. Alison Morris, Head of Serious Organised Crime Policy, Divert and Deter. And I refer members to Papers 3 and 4. And I invite the Cabinet Secretary to make some very brief opening remarks on the first of our LCMs, the Police Crime Sentencing and Courts Bill, and then we will move on to any questions on that LCM. So, Cabinet Secretary.
Thanks, Convener. The LCM for the Judicial Review and Courts Bill relates really to a minor provision in the schedule to the bill. It's uncontroversial, relates to fines enforcement. There is provision within the schedule which has the effect that Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service will be able to enforce a new type of financial penalty imposed in England and Wales through their online justice procedure. Cross-border enforcement of fines, of course, is a long-standing approach within the nations of the UK. And the UK Government and the Scottish Government agree on the need for cross-border enforcement as a normal part of the operation of respective justice systems. It relates to the fact that people within the UK can obviously move between nations, and so where, as in this case, a person who receives a financial penalty through this new online procedure moves to Scotland, then enforcement in Scotland is needed. However, there is an issue that is worth mentioning for the committee. The Scottish Government believes that the provision necessitates an LCM, whereas the UK Government believes it does not require an LCM. But as the LCM explains, fines enforcement is devolved, so we consider that any additional provision which adds responsibilities for SCTS to enforce fines imposed in England and Wales devolved and therefore necessitates an LCM. The UK Government disagree, arguing that the provision in the schedule could not be included in the Scottish Bill and as such is out with competence. The Parliament agrees with the Scottish Government's position, which is why you now have it in front of you. We believe the position is that the purpose of the relevant provision, which namely is to empower the Courts and Tribunal Service to enforce fines imposed in England and Wales, is devolved, and it's only through the manner in which the provision is drafted that takes the provision out with competence. So the purpose of the provision is clearly devolved. As the LCM was accepted for lodging, as I say, the Scottish Parliament appears to agree the necessity for an LCM has been triggered by the bill. Finally, it's important to stress the LCM does not mean the Scottish Government supports the entire policy content of the bill. I'm aware of other provisions in the bill which have created some controversy, such as changes to the operation of judicial review powers. This LCM is very narrow, only about the fines enforcement issue. Happy to take any questions of officials to do so, Convener.
Okay, thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. I think just for clarity, your remarks were in relation to the Judicial Review and Courts Bill. That's absolutely fine. So what I'll maybe do is ask if you would be able to just make your brief remarks in relation to the Police Crime Sentencing and Courts Bill, LCM, and then we can maybe take questions after that.
Right, apologies, I've got the wrong one there, Convener, but happy to cover the second of the LCMs. Again, grateful to the committee for the chance to take questions on the Supplementary Legislative Consent Memorandum for the Police Crime Sentencing and Courts Bill today, which the committee's had before it previously. It covers the extraction of data clauses, which are intended to clarify the existing position following the Information Commissioner's report on procedures in England and Wales, and the measures are not intended to create any new powers. The Government lodged an LCM on the 5th of August for those provisions which extend to Scotland. At the time of lodging, I advised that the Government was not in a position to be able to recommend consent for the power to extract information from digital devices of witnesses, victims and others, as discussions at that time were still ongoing between the former Lord Advocate and UK Ministers. I also stated my intention, once a position around the investigation of deaths was resolved satisfactorily, bring forward a supplementary memorandum for these provisions in order to ensure a consistent approach that takes account of Scotland's distinct position. And following confirmation from the UK Government that the issue of investigation of deaths will be kept under review once in force, we have now concluded that the identified risk is not sufficiently material prevent the Scottish Government recommending that the Scottish Parliament consent to these provisions.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. So I'll just open up to members, and I'll ask firstly if anyone has got any questions in relation to the Police Crime Sentencing and Courts Bill LCM. So if you can just indicate if you have any questions on that one. Nope. Okay, I'm not seeing any indication. Nope. Okay, that's fine. And likewise, just ask if any members have any questions in relation to the Judicial Review and Courts Bill LCM. Again, if you can just indicate with an R or put your hand up. No. Okay, thank you very much. So we'll, in that case, we'll now move on to the next item. And our next item of business is consideration of any issues for our final reports on the LCMs. And let me start again with the Police Crime Sentencing and Courts Bill. Any final views from members that they wish to include in the committee's report on the LCM? No, I'm not seeing anything at all. So on that basis, no issues have been raised by members. So that being the case, does the committee agree that the Scottish Parliament should give its consent to the relevant provisions in the Police Crime Courts and Sentencing Bill as set out in the Scottish Government's draft motion? Thank you. And are members content to delegate to me the publication of a very short factual report on the outcome of our deliberations on the LCM? Okay, thank you very much indeed. So the issue now moves to the Chamber for all members to decide on the basis of the report that we will prepare. Thank you very much for that. And if I can now turn to the second LCM, the Judicial Review and Courts Bill. Again, I'll invite any members to share their views on any issues that they would like to include in the committee's report on this LCM. I'd like just to indicate or put an R in the chat function. Not seeing anything. Okay. Thank you very much. So no issues have been raised by members, and that being the case, does the committee agree that the Scottish Parliament should give its consent to the relevant provisions of the Judicial Review and Courts Bill as set out in the Scottish Government's draft motion? Are you all happy with that? Thank you very much. Are members content to delegate to me the publication of a very short factual report on the outcome of our deliberations on this LCM? Thank you very much. So the issue will now, as before, move to the Chamber for all members to decide on the basis of our report. Thank you. So that concludes our consideration of these two LCMs. And